Father, we want to draw near to you, Father. We pray, Father, that as we go through this morning and as we start working through some things in your word, that you would open up our hearts and maybe even change some of our paradigms today, Father. We all come with different baggage and different things, Father. We pray that your Holy Spirit would be able to work through all of that and teach us truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys. Appreciate you. Go and have a seat. Good morning, church. Someone left this in the ladies' bathroom. I'm not expecting you to come right now and get it, but it's going to be right there. All right. Huh? How did I find it? Wow. Well, Karen. Yeah, don't you want to go back on vacation? Isn't it time? Oh, yes. So, wow, am I really loud? This sounds... That's right. couple things. First of all, this week we got this great email. Matt and Carmen, you know, met with the counselors at the school and said, hey, what can we do? So they've kind of come over these different initiatives that will be happening through the year, and not everyone is needed for everything. And so they just kind of asked for a few volunteers to help with the spring break food. And basically it's just providing meals. We have some people here at the school who basically would be without, literally would be struggling without food in this area, which is just amazing, huh? And so they arranged for, I think, three families, right? And they got this great email from one of the families saying, I wanted to send this email per our conversation today in hopes that you will get it to the church who has helped my family so very much. Words cannot say how very grateful and humble I am by the church's support for families in this community. Being a single parent with kids can be a struggle, as you may know, but the blessings outweigh any of the struggles. Please let them know from our family that we are very grateful and thankful for their support. Being on a very limited income has its challenges to make sure that everything that my children's needs are met. But I know that God does provide. Their support, love, and compassion is not going noticed, and my prayer is that God continues to bless them and their congregation. What they provided for food for my family is wow. That's what she says. It eases some of the stressors for the single mom to be able to know that he will provide. So, sometimes just being the people of God in simple ways does amazing things. We have Sean and his family on vacation this week, spring break. And one thing I wanted to tell you while he was gone, and he said, yeah, no one really knows what's going on. I said, yeah, I know. I'll talk to him when you're not here. So let's talk about Sean. Sean's been was at Coal Creek for many, many years, almost two decades, and is a lead pastor for the last 6 years. And about a year 13, somewhere along in there, he was told he could have a sabbatical. And it never happened because he then transitioned into lead pastoring and some other things. And so one of the things that I told Sean when we were kind of discussing this whole thing is that, you know, buddy, I want you to go get some rest. And it's been a long haul. And he has led extremely well. And as David and Castor and the elders have at Coal Creek. And so he's going to be here, and he's going to be here for two or three weeks, do Easter. And guys are on the Easter choir. He's having a great time with that. But sometimes guys need to just get regenerated and figure out, you know, what's God doing in my life, and what's, you know, I answer all these questions. He just turned 40, let's just face it, right? It's just, if he comes back with a red sports car, we'll know it's really just midlife crisis. I think sometime mid-May, he and I are going to go to a conference together in Dallas, a Catalyst conference, first weekend in May, and we'll be back on that Sunday, and then I think it's the following week that he's going to be gone for, he's about 2 months, about seven Sundays is what it is. And so we've already got things planned, some guest leaders and stuff in place, and he's working hard on that. But he feels kind of like, well, this is kind of weird. I just came to this church, but I just want you guys all to know that was all pre-planned, and very, very, very much want to offer him this time to go and be regenerated. So support him in that. Support his family in that, okay? So... So we are going to fly through some stuff today, guys, and we're going to end with teaching time. And you guys clock watchers out there, if Clock watchers just know that when I say, let's stand up and pray, we're done. All right? I even told the band, just save your voices, you know. Kirby, you're like in a musical over at Newport Covenant. Is that what I hear? Yeah. Fiddler on the Roof, and that last one's today at 3 o'clock, right? Go see him. It's free. 3 o'clock. Fiddler on the Roof. Doors open at 2:30. And they've been turning people away. So because Kirby's in it. Yeah. Are they going to let you play the main guy today, the guy with the big beard? And hopefully. All right. So get your Bibles out. Let's get going on this. So we are going to go through an eldership selection process over the next couple of months, hopefully no longer than that. And then the way our bylaws call for it, at some point here in the future, we will be, the elders are starting to put together names of people, and we're going to solicit if there's anyone that really is on your heart. We're not just going to ask for any names, just listen to the teaching this week and next week, and then if God places someone on your heart, be sure and bring that to us. We'll be talking with these people, and then we'll put a slate of elders before you for kind of a vote of affirmation. We feel like by that time we've already vetted them. We don't vote on individuals in this church. Too much stuff's happened, in, not with this church, but in past churches, and that's just, we don't really feel like a great way to handle it. So this is, we're going to explain a little bit about kind of our process and everything, but as I was studying this, I really started thinking more about the body of Christ and needing to get some things settled kind of in this arena here, and then we'll talk more about elders next week, all right? So it's going to be like a little mini study on biblical eldership. First, we're going to kind of lay out what they are, who they are, not who physically are, but what do elders do, and what are they responsible for? And I'm going to give you some scriptures. We're not even going to get into most of these today. We're going to get into most of them next week. But the scriptures that really deal in the New Testament with the elders is 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. It's Titus 1. So remember, 1 Timothy 3, Titus 1, which is written to a brand new church in Crete, which is interesting because they'll cover things that Timothy doesn't cover. And there's probably some really cool reasons why that is. We'll get into that next week. Hebrews chapter 13, 17, and then also 1 Timothy 5, about 17 through 20 deals with elders and more of their role of oversight on a church. So one thing we have to decide as a church, folks, is what do we value? And I know you hear me say that a lot. What do we value as a church? And then let's make sure that our leaders that we put in place are there to protect what we value, right? And hopefully what we value is what God values. So what are the main four roles of the elders? I think boil it down to four here, and number one would be leadership. They are kind of overseeing they're overseeing the church as a whole. 1 Timothy 5 talks about that they are to oversee the affairs of the church. We'll get into more details on that next week. Second thing is that they are a shepherd. As a shepherd watches after the sheep, then they have this responsibility to shepherd. That's found in several different places, but one of the places that I think was most significant is in Ezekiel 34, and it talks about God is calling to task the shepherds who were over Israel at that time for feeding themselves and not caring about the people. In other words, everything that they were doing was for self, and they really weren't shepherding. They were kind of shepherding each other. And he calls, boy, the whole chapter, I mean, God is just calling them to task through Ezekiel in chapter 34. The third thing is that an elder needs to be able to teach. And maybe not stand up here and be comfortable and confident in teaching up here, but sitting down one-on-one or in a small group and someone is having a struggle or something, they need to be able to sit down and open the scriptures and say, you know, this is what the Bible says, right? We're not gonna take man's opinion here, but this is what the Bible says about this and teach someone. That's in 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1. The other thing we see is that they are to equip people. The church's responsibility for all of us is that we're equipped, so that we're equipped to be God's workmen and workwomen out there, and so that we can be that conduit for His grace. We can be that conduit where the Holy Spirit convicts people because they're seeing what we're doing and seeing God's handiwork through us. And so with that, then the next question I had to ask myself was, and you guys are on Facebook, some of you participated. This was cool. 34 likes. I like that. It's like one of the first things I ever posted on Facebook. I thought, I'll give this a shot, and people started piping in. But the question is, what holds us together? What holds you over there together with you over here, and you may not even know each other? So I asked that question. You guys want to know some of the answers? Here we go. Our common love of Jesus. Justin, just because you're here today, I'm going to do the protons and electrons, is what you said, and thank you for coming back three times and giving us more powerful things than that. But that is true. Our individual and collective submission to the Holy Spirit. Kelly? Vonda says the ability... No, actually, she spoke for Bill. Bill's never even seen Facebook, but Vonda spoke for him, and I know how this works, so here we go. The learned ability to see through the maze of human traditions and values, to see the true reality of Christ and Him crucified, and how that levels the playing field. Bill Fletcher. Have you ever appeared even in name on Facebook? I'll show you mine later. It's kind of cool, your name's on there. Suzette said, the choice, after she put me, I said, you can't do that. The choice to put aside our opinions and focus on the saving grace of Jesus for me and you. When we stop focusing on the faults of one another and fretting over their salvation and begin to focus on living all that out, holy and holy, full of the fruit of the Spirit, that we begin to influence one another to do the same. It's freedom, short answer. It is His peace, love, and joy of God that allows us to live in unity. Jill said, His transforming love connects us all together. James says, being and doing together. Donna, above all, you're my family, but Donna says. And Carly, of course, Jesus is always the answer. Bingo, there you go. Since Sunday school, that's always been the answer. Some might say that we're held together by common interests, things that hold us together, maybe some of us like to go fishing together, or some of us like, maybe we have certain hobbies, some of you like to sew together. Some of you had political interests that are very alike. And although I would like to tell you that that's really what's going to hold you together, at the end of the day, it's not going to hold you together. In fact, I would guess it's probably going to divide some of you. What holds us together is the fact that we have all experienced God's grace in our life. The church is made up of people of all walks of life that we've been rescued from ourselves. And we've seen grace given by God through Jesus. And it's only because we've experienced it that we can then extend it to others. It's awfully hard to extend grace to someone else if you've not experienced it yourself. I really do think that a lot of the strife in churches happens because people never have accepted that grace that God's given them, and they just want to be cantankerous the rest of their life by not showing other people grace. He saved some of us sitting in Sunday school one time. He saved others in a church service or in a crusade somewhere. He rescued others while battling for our lives in some sort of addiction. Saved others while they were least expecting it. He saved others literally on their deathbed. He saved others while they were dabbling in all these different religions and philosophies in life. He saved some in the midst of a horrible divorce. He saved some at summer camp when you heeded the call to accept the grace of Jesus. No matter what your story, we were all dead at one time, but now we have life. And it's not because of anything you or I did, but it's all because of Jesus. And that grace, folks, is what will hold us together. Do you believe that? Tom believes it. Do you believe that? So if we're all saved by and held together by grace, we have to get our arms around what kind of relationship is that? First of all, what kind of relationship is that we have with God? And he calls it a covenant relationship. He extends it through His love, which is a different kind of love than I just love pizza, right? Or I just love your dress, or I just love your hair, or I just love you so much. I mean, what it really is an unconditional love called agape love. And it's through that He extends His love, He extends His grace through that. In fact, if you go back to Revelation chapter 5, it's going to be on the screen here. It says this in chapter 9. Where it talks about kind of how He's called us into this covenant relationship and who it is that does the work in this. And they sang a new song saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and by your blood you ransomed people for God. From every tribe and language and people and nation. That God ransomed us through the blood of Jesus. And you've made them a kingdom and priests to our God. And they shall reign on the earth. God purchased us when we were dead in our sin and we were held captive with no way out. And through the blood of Jesus and only through his blood were we ransomed. And now we stand, as Bill said, at the level foot of the cross. Romans 8 reminds us at the end of this how this really works. Get this. It's not going to be on the screen. What then shall we say in response to all this? Some of your favorite verses, right? If God is for us, who can be against us? Right? How many of you like this verse? Okay, well, maybe the rest of you will fall in love with it. Here we go. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? Is it God who justifies? Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall trouble? What's going to separate you from each other? Trouble? What, disagreements? It's like the peanut gallery down here. Who's going to separate you from the love of Christ? Trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness? That might separate us. Or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present or the future, any other powers, neither height nor depth, anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Is there anything he left out? What's going to separate us from the love of God? And the only way that works, folks, is because he's got your back. Because he's made a commitment to you in this covenant relationship that he is going to do what is in your best interest. There's a difference between a contract and a covenant. And so many of us live life as a contract. You have a contract with your cell phone person, right? You know that contract that you sign, and in the fine print, when you go to turn off your phone someday, they say, by the way, you owe us $4,000. What? It's in the contract. It's a contract is something you sign or you agree to, and it's you do this and I'll do this. You agree to something under these certain terms, but a covenant is different. It's not built around bartering for services. It's basically entering into a relationship with this attitude. In a way that we give ourselves to each other. What do I bring to this relationship? Now, follow me here, because if we're in this kind of relationship with God, and then Scripture calls the church the body of Christ in Ephesians chapter 5, that's where he says, women, be submissive to your husbands, and we go, oh, but then there we go. All the guys, and we don't read the next part, that says, guys, you treat your wife like Jesus treated the church, and you give her everything. You go as far to the end of the earth as you can. Not, this is my paraphrase. It's longer than it is in the Scripture, though. So, love your wife like Christ loved the church. And how did Christ love the church? Through covenant love. And so if we've got this, if the church has this covenant love with God, this covenant agreement with God, And he's brought that imagery into the marriage, which is how marriages are supposed to work, then marriage is a covenant. It's not a contract. And so what we end up with is, how do the people of God then treat each other? We'll get there in just a minute. But you know what? We need to have this illustration of the wedding right quick. So we need a wedding venue, first of all. Let's go away. Oh, there's a wedding venue right there. Gosh, it looks like we're like overlooking something. Can we get a near bride and groom sitting right down here? Let's call up Amanda and Kai right quick. Mom and Dad, you don't mind if we just go ahead and get it done here, do you? I know Akira, you could care less. You're like, yes. You guys, you think I'm way too casual today. got a reason for everything I do. Can we have some music? Just kidding. All right. All right, you guys come on up here. Akira, because you're not giving away, this didn't really happen, all right? Okay, so come on up here. We'll be practicing this a little bit later on in the summer, but you stand, I think this is right, yeah. So can you guys see him? Okay, we're at the wedding venue. This is gorgeous. You're under the arbor. And so first of all, I want to do this a little bit backwards because don't touch her because she's not giving away everybody's dad. This isn't real, all right? So I just want you to know this, all right? And the church said, this is not real. And the church said, amen. All right, so, Amanda, because you are the traditional sweetheart that you are, you chose these traditional wedding vows. And so would you please repeat after me? I, Amanda, take you, Kai.
I, Amanda, take you, Kai.
To be my fiancé.
To be my fiancé.
To have and to hold hands with from this day forward.
To have and to hold hands with.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poor.
For richer or for poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
And I'm just going to leave it there in case, when the actual moment happens, but I just want to stop short of that. So what Amanda did is she just gave her vows, and that's the point of the ceremony. Everyone goes, oh, right? Right? You go to a wedding, and everyone, you do the vows, and I mean, I can always hear it. It's like, oh, you know, you just kind of hear the sigh through the crowd because those are sweet. Now, Kai wants to do more of a contractual type marriage, and so Kai, repeat after me. I, Kai, take you, Amanda, to be my fiancé. To have and to hold from this day forward,
for better or worse,
for richer or poor,
as long as you are meeting my needs,
my love will be given unconditionally, except upon the following missteps you may make.
Dinner at 6 p.m.,
all my ironing, and I promise to give it a good shot for 5 years and see how it's going. Okay, stop right there. All right, so, thanks, guys. You guys are awesome. Have a seat. All right, we're giving up. So, that is the difference between covenant and contract. The contractual... you guys... Do we have that on video? All right. So a covenant is based on what I bring to the table. For the good of the other, for richer or poorer, better or worse. There's not an if, however, at the end of it. Imagine how difficult a marriage can be when one comes contractually and the other comes in covenant. When one comes in conditional love and the other comes with unconditional love. Now, I'm no idiot, folks. Some of you might be living in that kind of situation. It's not going to work very well. As members of God's covenant relationship, we are to be in covenant relationship with one another. In fact, it's expressed in so many different ways in Scripture, but there's 59 specific one another's in Scripture, 14 of them being love one another. Oh, could that possibly be agape love? I think so. Can you imagine what it would be like if some of us were perfect? I know some of you are going, what's so big about that? That those who were perfect would not be able to relate to me. And I personally would feel very awful just being in your perfect midst.
I wouldn't feel welcome or understood or even feel like I had a right to be here because of my sin. Welcome the way so many churches make people feel when they walk in and everyone's got their facades on. Growing up, I thought, wow, when I was a little kid, as long as I put on a tie, I thought, well, as long as you wear a tie and women wear a dress, you're good. It's good, you know, a little growing up in these little conservative churches. That was, you know, I always wonder, why do the deacons go out back and smoke cigarettes when they're ties? That kind of blows off the whole thing. I just couldn't figure that out, you know, growing up in the South. What's the relationship that we have? When we come as contractual members, it's easy to push away from the table. In a marriage, this is what happens. You're there and you're with each other and you're sitting there and you don't like what each other does. And so it's easy if you're in a contractual part, say you didn't fulfill your part, you push away from the table. Church is no different. What do you mean you're not going to do what I want to do? What do you mean? I mean, I have doctrinally everything we line up. I mean, this is it, but you know, you're going to do what? You're going to play that kind of music? You're going to do that with our Sunday schools? You're going to, hang on, you said, no one's greeted me for the last five times I've come in this place. And it's so easy when you're in that kind of thing. What's not done for me? Push away from the table. We see it all the time. We come as contractual members. It's easy to push away from the table. And people push away from different reasons and for different ways. They withhold their affection. They withhold their time. They withhold their finances. And instead of looking for opportunities to serve and invest, they look for the next way to criticize those who are investing and serving. And a covenant says that we're staying at the table with this intent of working it out all to God's glory through his healing. Folks, let me tell you what, there's some people that have been here for 13 years. And the only reason, you guys can amen me on this, the only reason we're still at this table together is because we decided a long time ago that we're going to stay here with the intent of working it out to God's glory. And we've had ups and downs. That's part of human nature, right? That's part of our brokenness. That's part of our fallenness. And God says, but there's nothing that can separate you from me. Verses 59:1. Not the verses of expectation, but they're verses of action. And this is what I want us to hear today. You must decide today, folks. You must decide whether you approach the local church as a consumer or as one participating in a covenant relationship. Am I saying there's no reason to ever leave a church? No, I'm not saying that. I'd be happy to have that conversation with you. There are times where, I mean, you know, there are times where things are being taught, you don't have any business, and the leadership won't stand up and defend the word of God. Absolutely. Or you move, or, you know, all these different reasons. But so often in our world, folks, it's just, they call it swelling in Dallas. I mean, it's just not that prevalent up here, but in so many different parts of the country, it's like, new church starts over here, they get a great speaker, and all of a sudden it's, and they grow, and then all of a sudden, and that happens over here, and you know, and where's the covenant? Remember, covenant begins with this premise of, I'm going to become this for you. I hope and pray that there will be some reciprocity. This is how we go into our marriages. I'm bringing what God's given me into this marriage. I'm going to become this for you. And how much easier is that when there's reciprocity? A lot easier, isn't it? But if there's not, I'm still going to serve you in this way. So one of the roles of an elder, I believe, is through their shepherding with wisdom and understanding the authoritative word of God, is to protect and encourage this covenantal relationships that the church is made out of. See, that's one thing that say, you know, I wish our elders would make, you know, different color carpet, or I wish they would, you know. But you know what? That's not really what the elders are for. The elders are for protecting the flock. An elder cannot expect the flock to be living in covenant relationship, or him living in covenant relationship, and the flock that he's trying to lead and shepherd be living in contractual relationship. So what does this realistically look like? Let me just give you some ideas. You could do these in your home groups and come up with 100, 1,000 ideas. Let me make this real practical. Do you walk in on a Sunday morning or into your home group or simply into relationships with others and anticipating a bringing of something to the table or of others just kind of serving you? Now, there's times in our life where we're real needy, but sometimes that neediness can become a habit where we stop relying on God and we're relying on the voices of men to give us what we're really needing. Greeting one another. Do you come ready and willing to greet, or are you just counting the times when no one's greeted you? I walked through 5 people today and no one said hello to me. I want to go, well, did you say hello back? One of those attitudes builds community and the other one breaks it down. Are the menial jobs always someone else's task that you can be served and comfortable? Or do you come to the table ready to go, you know what? I'm gonna do this because I don't want to do it, but I'm going to do it. I told Jeff this week, he said, I'm going to clean the office this week. I said, how come I didn't get on this list to clean the office? I feel horrible. Guys, staff, I'm sorry about that. Somehow this office cleaning is happening. All the staff's taking turns once a week cleaning the office. And they did it when I was out of town. And I didn't get on the list. I feel horrible about that. I'm going to go kick someone off their list because I want to be a part of that. Pat, no, not you. So we'll see. I'm going to take bids for that later. We're going to have an auction with the staff. And so, but when I come to this table of community, folks, when I come to the table of community, I want to come with one another's in mind. That I'm going to be, and you can look at your sheet because they're all on here, I'm going to be gracious with one another and peaceful. And I want to be non-judgmental. And I want to find out how to forgive each other because, you know, I kind of stink at that sometimes. I need to be humble and non-envious. I want to be encouraging and honoring of one another. And I want to have this equal concern with everyone. Even when I'm having a too many people day. You guys ever have those? I'm just being honest with you. He says with a smile. Betty. When I come to this table of church community, I want to forgive my grievances. And I want to spur each other on to gifts and good works because that's what Scripture told me to do. That's what Jesus told me to do. Do I want to do it every time? No. Is it convenient? No. Is it my job? Is it your job? As a Christ lover, it's my job. And I want to love each other deeply. And I want to greet each other with a holy kiss. That's said 3 times in Scripture. I'm not really sure exactly what that looks like. Probably a little cultural thing there. I want to submit to one another. I want to love and use whatever gift you've been given to serve others, the Scripture says. To serve others. You guys are still on this holy kiss thing over here. Just get off the holy kiss thing. I come to the table willing to confess, willing to be accountable and concerned and compassionate towards you, even though I may even have a hard time carrying it that particular moment. Some of you go, wow, this is your pastor? No, I'm just telling you why I struggle sometimes with this. Because sometimes after a long week of being caring and compassionate, it's difficult. But do you know what the Bible says? The Bible says you be that to one another. And there could be a day, you know, you say, I hope someone comes and encourages me. No, please don't send me lots of emails this week. That's not what I'm saying. But it's reciprocal, you see, and that's how the body of Christ works. The one another's cannot become our test for being involved. It can't become your litmus test for how is this church serving me and how is it doing for me. And it says right here that the one another say this, and that you've never ever looked at it as it is your responsibility and my responsibility to be that to one another because that's what covenant relationship means. And you may never get it back, folks. You may never get it back, but you can join the forces of going here and going there. And tell me, the grass is always greener until winter hits. Right? There is, or August in our case here in Texas, it's when winter hits. In August, the grass is always greener here until August if you don't water. Right? And then you go and you go, wow, it's not even greener here either. What God says is, you know what, we're just going to be in covenant relationship with each other. If you don't come to the table ready to invest and engage with the one another, you'll find yourself pushing away from that table at some point. But because people will always disappoint you. Folks, listen, if you go, I've just been at this church for a month, and I'm really, this is a great church. Just give us a couple weeks, okay? Someone will probably disappoint you. Because we're human. We'll never be perfect enough. And same with marriage, folks. I can't leave this and not talk about marriage. And Suzette and I, we don't have this conversation very much, but several years ago, I mean, we were at the point where for the first time in my life, I thought, you know what? And she was having the same thought. I could probably do without this guy for a while. I was thinking, you know what? I don't know that it's worth the battle. Some of you are out there thinking about that same thing right now. And first thing we had to decide was, that's just totally off the table. Shame on us. He convicted us very quickly about that. And it took someone bringing us back into covenant with each other. We love hanging out with each other. I love giving myself to her and her, and I love when she gives herself to me. But I'm not going to be dependent on her. Folks, your marriage is struggling. That's what it's going to take. That is covenant love. There's no other way to skirt around it. We break our side of the covenant. We hope and pray that there's that forgiveness and love so that you can bring it back. And you have to be intentional about it. So, folks, my plea to you is, before we stand, is don't let this just be another lesson where you go, wow, I feel really convicted. And life goes on. How is it speaking to you in your heart right now? And that's the Holy Spirit alive and well. The Holy Spirit totally alive and well. You find very few Christians who don't think that elders are supposed to be servant leaders, leading you from a place of service and humility, and that is absolutely correct. But my question to you is, if you agree with that statement, then do you also believe that the rest of the church is to be doing the same thing in reciprocal living towards each other? And if you believe that, then join us as we put a group of men together who will help us and lead us. And we want to ask them to protect that. Protect it. It comes right out of the Word of God. Amen. Let's stand. Father, I'm thankful for the healing power that you've had in so many of these people's lives that are out here today. There's so many that could be standing up here and testifying like I did about our marriage, about your healing power on that, and how my heart will never be turned, will never be turned from my wife. And Father, I pray that as we muddle our way through figuring out this whole church thing, that Father, we would just stand on the ground that we're in covenant relationship with each other, whatever that looks like. And there will be times, Father, we're challenged with leaving, or we're maybe dealing with something that we've left in the past. And Father, I just pray for a new start today. That maybe we have a new understanding. And your Holy Spirit's convicted us at this very moment for that. So let's not worry about the past. Let's just do like Paul says and press on from today. So Father, may we press on just exhibiting in different ways that people, when they look at this body of Christ, just see the one another's happening all the time. May we be convicted of that. May we read through these. Father, would you protect this body of Christ that I love so dearly? Protect them this week as they work. Would you give them extremely productive weeks in their workplace? Father, I pray that as you entrust us, Father, with your things, and in our generosity grows, that you would just continue to open the floodgates of blessings in our lives, whatever that may look like. Father, the marriages that need to be healed, Father, by the name of Jesus and in his mighty name, Father, would you begin that healing process now, as possibly two hands touch each other that haven't reached out for each other in a year. It's only through your power that kind of thing can happen. May this always be a not just a healing community, but as Dr. Meyer said, a restorative community. Restore us, Father. And the church says, amen.